Good evening, Scotland. Good evening, social media land. I hope you are well. Welcome to That Indy Show. It is Monday, the 31st of October, 2022, and happy Halloween to you all. We are recording tonight's live again for the security and integrity of the message and the ability to upload and share via other platforms. Tonight is all about the lies and spin of Better Together. However, I could not go into that without an update on our favourite Home Secretary, Cruella de Vil Braverman.
The Home Secretary, Suella Braverman, has admitted that she sent official documents to her personal email address on six occasions. The security breaches led to her resignation, before she was then reappointed to the same role by Rishi Sunak less than a week later. While Suella Braverman gave the explanation in a letter to the chair of the Home Affairs Select Committee, in which she again apologises for her mistakes.
This government will have integrity. Integrity.
Integrity.
Professionalism and accountability at every level.
Aye, so it will, Rishi. Honestly. So, just as a update for Cruella, because we did a whole show on her last week. She has used her personal email address to handle official documents on seven occasions now. An internal Home Office inquiry has discovered this. That's her own people dobbing her in. Two Whitehall officials also confirmed media reports that Braverman had blocked the use of hotel accommodation for asylum seekers at the Manston Centre, where 4,000 migrants are packed into space for just 1,600 people. You know what? Using hotels might not be ideal, but it would reduce the number of migrants on the site and relieved a bit of the pressure. She has also claimed that Britain's asylum system is broken and illegal immigration is out of control, and that we have an invasion of illegal immigration. You can make a song out of that. But when some 96% of applications submitted by migrants making the journey across here in 2021 are still outstanding, I tend to think that it's not really an invasion. It's just a bit of admin problems going on there, Cruella. Anyway, on top of that, there was a man that also attacked the immigration post centre, whatever you want to call it, the new border force place down in Dover. I just wonder, okay, what media and political dialogue empowered him to do such a thing? Shocking. Shocking. Okay, tonight is all about the spin and lies of Better Together. And I found an article, it's an old one now, reported in the Press and Journal way back, I think it was 2015. It's also published stuff from Business for Scotland that highlights several of the key promises made by Better Together that were never kept. And I thought it would be interesting to discuss them here tonight. I also have three of the videos used by Better Together to spin the no message and manipulate the soft yes voters into voting no. We shall discuss these two. So shall we begin?
The Saltire is also on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and TikTok. You will find the links to follow us on all of them at www.thesaltire.scot/media.
Okay, who do we have in the chitty chat tonight? Let's have a quick look. Quite a few of you. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. This is great. Susie, good evening. First person on tonight. Callum. And who else do we got? There's Kathleen. Hi, Kathleen. How are you? Hope you're good. Thank you for dropping in. It was a fun live going on James's one about 10 minutes ago. I don't think I've giggled so much in ages. I did my best to keep my composure, though. I'm barely conscious. Thank you very much for coming in. Indy James, there he is. Good lad. I'm not going to say anything. This is a serious live tonight. We have to be serious. Okay, let us start then. So there are details in the article I'm about to discuss that is relevant to around about 2014 to early 2016. So most of the article is pre-Brexit. So I've updated some of the points to make them relevant for today. So we'll go through them point by point. We'll throw the videos in. We'll come back and see what you guys are saying in the chat as well to make it break it up a bit. So it's not really just all me talking boring stuff. Okay. So the first point in the article was renewable subsidies. And this goes back to the actual Better Together campaign in 2015, where Ed Davey, the UK Energy Secretary, said Scotland could lose billions in renewable energy subsidies, with a yes vote, that is, and would put our green energy revolution at risk. Davey also claimed that 33% of UK subsidies for wind, wave and tidal projects were worth £530 million a year came to Scotland, and so an independent Scotland would slam the brakes on wind farm projects. Wow, that's a lot of nonsense in my opinion. Now, drastic cuts to public funding onshore wind farms have been announced, which Renewable Scotland claim would reduce Scotland's economy by £3 billion. That is back in 2014. You have to remember that, okay? Then, remember that carbon capture thing away up in the northeast? They talked about this then as well. So they talked about that carbon capture project in the northeast, and Davey also claimed that the vital climate change project at Peterhead would be endangered as they signed a deal with Shell and Scottish and Southern Energy about this. However, after the 2016 Brexit referendum, Westminster pulled its promised £1 billion of support. Do you remember that? Okay, and on top of that, okay, if we were independent, this is the update, if we were independent, you know, excuse me, we wouldn't get the subsidies because would be funding ourselves. Our taxation, our borrowing powers and our fiscal policy would allow us to naturally invest in our abundant renewable potential. This is something now that cannot be spun negatively and used to manipulate voters. We know exactly the potential of our renewable energies. Right, so the next point in this, okay, was EU membership wasn't secure. Okay, so David Cameron claimed way back in 2014 that the only way to protect Scotland's EU membership was to reject independence. We all know what happened there. We live it every day with the cost of living crisis, and only a fool would believe that the war in Ukraine is the principal reason for our economy falling down the sewer. We have to remember it was right-wing separatist British nationalists and maybe a wee bit of soft racism there, and anti-European sentiment that decided on Scotland's membership of the EU, even though 62% of us voted to remain. Now in a recent poll, 72% of Scots want a return to the EU. So wake up, no voters. If you're a no voter and you are an EU returner, then the only way that you'll get back into the EU is to be part of an independent Scotland. So consider a yes vote next time. Point number sort of 3/4 in this was Labour's majority promise. Way back in 2014, Labour, who led the No campaign in Scotland, claimed that they would not, that not only would independence consign the rest of the UK to a permanent Tory rule, but a Labour government would sort out Scotland's problems. How nice of them. Labour may be ahead in the polls today, but they are now officially hard Brexiteers and want to make Brexit work just like the Tories. They also deny Scottish democracy by defying the mandate that the Scottish voters have given the Scottish government for the past 12 years. That's pretty bad. But Labour are also now selling their soul by getting cosy and warm, cuddling up to the Tories in local councils up here, forming alliances, creating the councils to block the party with the most councillors, and that would have been the SNP. This is not spoken enough and is actually disgusting. I know Unionist Labour voters up here that have expressed their wish to now turn to vote for the SNP or any other Indy party, and they want independence to escape this hellish travesty. I would also like to point out, and this is a very important point on that, it is not Scotland's job to vote to save the English left-wing parties. You brought the fall of Labour in this country upon yourself, and that's something you have to live with. Okay? Good. Right. We will now break up this lovely party with another little video. This is the first of the Better Together campaign videos from 2014. It's a bit dark, and I'll tell you a bit about it after we've watched it. It's about 2.5-3 minutes long.
Somewhere, tucked away in the North Sea of our planet Earth, there is a small island. Our island. This small island of ours, and the people who live here, are bound together by more than earth and rock. We are bound together by over 300 years of common history. Common achievements that measure far beyond our geographical size, and have made us one of the greatest countries on our planet. We are united by the first ever national health service in the world. Our health service. We are protected by the strongest defense in Europe. Many of our companies are bound together to give them the global strength to compete in the modern world. Our industries help each other win the orders that are their lifeblood. Our pensioners, our companies, our children's schools, our world-class universities are protected by the resources of the whole island. Together we have built a combined voice, which gives us a space in the very top councils of the world. We are bound together by one of the oldest and strongest currencies in the world. And we are united by the ties of family and friendship with not only the other inhabitants of this small island, but the 500,000 of our fellow Scots who live in other parts of our island. Now, we can still keep this island of ours together and still gain control over all our Scottish taxes and how they are spent. Or we can just cut ourselves off. Do we really want to become an even smaller island in this big, rapidly changing world? Do we really want to cut ourselves off from all that we have built together? Forever? On Thursday, vote no.
That was quite a dark, dark video. Quite a scary one. It was only broadcast once or twice during the 2014 referendum because it polled quite negatively amongst both unionist voters and people that were abstaining. It actually pushed more people towards yes, in all fairness. Right, let's have a look to see who's in the chit chat. PBC, nice to see you again. Nice to see you again, yeah, and Kathleen's doing lots of great chit-chat there, thank you very much. Tonight we're not going to talk about Ukraine, right? Let's try not to talk about those sort of things. Let's keep it to the subject if possible, please. Kathleen, I've given you moderator rights, okay, for this live, just so you've got that, all right? I don't have any straight fast rules, but if there's anything that could potentially get this live knocked off in the chat for any reason, by all means mute people. Okay, you have all about it. Okay, right, let's go back to what we're talking about. So we're going on to the next little pointer here. So point 5 in the article was Scotland should lead, not leave the UK, which this is like an almost perfect piece of political spin. Now, Gordon Brown and John Lamont both said this, but nobody seemed to tell David Cameron. that the whole belief that Scotland would become a bigger player in the Union was destroyed because David Cameron never got the memo. The day after the referendum, he announced English votes for English laws, an aptly named evil. Effectively, this meant that any Scottish MP could not vote directly on any legislation solely for England. And also, wait for this, no MP from a Scottish constituency could ever become Prime Minister under this. What? I mean, really? That was just like pushing Scotland into a little box, you know, a little box. Now, some of us like Gordon Brown, some of us, you know, find him a bit offensive, but we will stick to middle of the road. I think he's a man that would potentially come round to independence more so now. He's always seems to be brought out a lot. You know, I don't know whether it's to scare people or anything. I mean, see, when he was, there's part of me that disagrees with him. There's part of me that kind of likes him. I don't know. I'm kind of in the middle about them all. But do you know what? We'll leave the Gordon Brown thing for another night. Okay, we'll leave it for another night. Right. So the next point was pensions are not safe if we were out of the UK. Now again, Gordon Brown warned that independence came with a pensions time bomb. The UK government backed that claim, and now the pension age has increased for women since the referendum, meaning that some women, the WASPI women, may lose out on £30,000 or more with their pensions. UK government policy since the referendum means that the middle to high earners will be better off through their pensions, while low earners will bear the cost of pension reforms. A Scot earning around about £15,000, £15,000 with a working life of 30 years could see their pension drop by about £1,800 per annum. Bear in mind, this is data from 2016. Okay, but now we have a Scottish government that now wants to bring the lowest pension in Europe up in line with the rest of the EU. But that'll only happen with independence. We also have a Tory government that had to have the Bank of England step in to save people's pensions just recently due to crass financial policies in that so-called mini budget. Crazy, crazy, crazy. Next one is the old currency one. It was Scotland's pound, basically. Scotland were told they could not continue to use sterling, okay, after independence. Denying claims that this was a political move, the No Camp claimed that the currency union was unworkable. However, on STV's Scotland Tonight, Sir Mervyn King, who ran the Bank of England for a decade, said it would have been totally feasible. There was no need for an independent currency. However, now I wouldn't touch it. Our plan now is to move to our own currency as soon as possible through basically a Scottish pound, creating our own central bank and issuing our own notes. And for all you naysayers and desk jockey economists that like to read scaremongering unionist think tank reports that hold no value in an independent Scotland, remind you that maybe Scotland would save and spend and invest in its economy in a different way than the union does. You need to ask yourself this: who would not invest in a country with an abundance of water and renewable energy available for manufacturing that sits on the doorstep of one of the largest market blocks in the world and would soon be a member of it again? Yeah, I know it's a bit hard to grasp that Scotland, with all that good stuff going on, would be a success. But you know what? The Scottish pound will easily become a sought-after, positively traded currency. It's true. Might take a year or so. Might take two. Might take 6 months. But do you know what? It's going to happen. Next little one is slower. We're coming on to oil, by the way, barely conscious. We will talk about that. Okay. Slower, meaningless devolution. David Cameron claimed, a no vote would lead to faster, fairer, safer and better change, and that draft legislation for new powers for Scotland would be in place by January 2015. John Swinney tells us almost every concession for more powers in the watered-down Smith Commission document had at least one Unionist party trying to block it. Scots now know that the Westminster negotiators tried to use the Scotland Bill fiscal agreement talks to cut Scotland's budget by £7 billion also over 10 years. I just don't get that. We've had, since Brexit, we've had legislation put in place to ensure a continuity of trade between the countries on the countries within these islands, okay? And that is just a technical power grab for things going on. And to be fair, all right, it is an absolute assault upon the devolution powers and shouldn't be done. Okay, we are going to go on to the second video for Better Together, the campaign that they put out. This one is basically from a young person's perspective.
We have a big decision to make.
It's the biggest choice any of us will make in our lives.
And the decision we will make will follow us from the rest of our lives.
In 2014, we will choose whether to stay together in the UK
or break away from the rest of Britain.
It is a big question, not whether Scotland could go it alone.
Of course we could, but whether it's the best choice for our future.
Right now, we get the best of both worlds.
A Scottish Parliament making decisions about things that are important to us.
Access to universities.
How well funded our colleges are.
Our school buildings.
Our teachers.
Our NHS.
But we also get the strength and security of being part of the United Kingdom.
We don't have to choose between the things that make Scotland great and the things that make Britain great.
The BBC.
The UK Armed Forces.
British music.
British art.
Team GB.
And so much more.
60 million people working together as a family.
The UK keeps us strong in a world of global forces that overwhelm other nations.
The different people of the UK are there for each other.
When RBS and the Bank of Scotland were about to collapse, it was taxpayers from all over the UK who stepped in.
We need more jobs and more opportunities if we are to have a better future.
So many jobs rely on UK investment.
Now is not the time to put our jobs at risk.
Let's increase the amount of opportunities we have, not reduce them.
Right now, thousands of us choose to go to university in England, Wales or Northern Ireland.
After independence, these would be foreign universities, and who knows what the funding situation would be.
We are proud that as part of the UK, we play a positive role in the world.
Campaigning on LGBT issues across the globe as part of the largest diplomatic network of any nation on earth.
Campaigning as part of a permanent member of the UN for human rights in places like Burma and Syria.
And saving millions of lives through the second largest aid budget on earth.
Sent around the world from the Department of International Development, which is based here in Scotland.
What makes us so different from our friends and families in England and Wales that we need to put up a border?
For 300 years, we have worked together.
We are linked politically.
Economically.
Socially.
Culturally.
Interdependence. Working together. Solidarity.
These are strengths, not weaknesses.
We will have more opportunity if we stick together.
We are stronger together.
We are better.
Together! Woo!
Okay, let's see what's going on in the chit chat there. Good night, Callum. You sleep well, my friend. Okay, lots of interesting chat about pensions I noticed there as well. You know what? Scotland does have a bit of an ageing population, but we can't encourage positive immigration into Scotland presently because we're not independent, so we can't prop that up with people coming across here to work. We just don't have that opportunity. And it's just... It will be quite scary to think that our population is ageing. And that's the pension time bomb that Gordon Brown has talked about. So Scotland within the Union, if we take the budget the way that it is, would probably struggle with doing things. However, that's got nothing to do with an independent Scotland who would be investing differently, spending differently, borrowing differently, and just doing things completely differently. You have to remember that we're not the Union, we're not Westminster. And that's kind of been proven by all the things that have happened in Scotland since 2014 as well. So it's not a case of taking it on faith. Many people do require figures, facts and numbers and things. But those are coming. These things are coming. They're doing a nice little drip feed of information and things with all the white papers and stuff. Where are we? Barely conscious. Because fine. Okay. Okay. Oh dear. Jesus has joined us. Hi, Jesus. Please be nice to James. Okay. We love you both. Dearly. Truly we do. Right. Okay. Let us move on. Let me put that music back on again. Let me just see how loud it is. That's okay. Right. Where did we get up to? Listen, see that video with all the youngsters there just now? I just wonder where they all are now. And how they feel now about making that video, you know? Let's move on with the article. We've only got a couple more sections to go. Okay, so, uncertainty. This was claimed by David Cameron that inward investors had told him they would not invest in Scotland until after the referendum due to uncertainty. But basically in 2014 and 2015, there was a record year for Scottish inward investment from outside the UK. The number of projects increased by 17% on April 2014 and between April 2014 and March 2015. And now, in present times, Scotland has received more investment from outside the UK than any other nation in the Union. And that's something that can't be refuted either. Then we go on to job losses. The No Camp claimed that Scottish HMRC tax offices would close and many jobs would be lost as they would also be collecting taxes for England at the time. Since the referendum, it has been announced that 2,500 tax office jobs in Scotland are to go. I think something, you need to realise something. We would have a tax office in Scotland. We would have a tax office with tax office jobs and tax office expertise. So what would go? You know, it drives me bananas to think that, yeah, okay, come independence, the Union would take everything, all the Scottish workers out of Scotland working in the tax office. Not going to happen. It is not going to happen. We would still require that expertise in that field. So again, okay, back in 2014, okay, talking about job losses, Better Together teamed up with the Steelworkers Union and the community of steelworkers to claim that a no vote would protect steel jobs. But now, since then, 270 steel jobs have gone in Scotland. So let's face it, we would create a new tax office and tax-related jobs and the infrastructure necessary for an independent Scotland. People must realise that we are not starting out with nothing. We will need the organisation of the offices of government to function. So any jobs lost to the Union Tax Office and other bodies of similar sort of capacity would be gained in an independent Scottish office type things. Does that not make sense? You know? Crazy. Okay, so border controls. That's the next one that was on the article. Former Scottish Secretary Alistair Carmichael launched a UK government report that entitled Borders and Citizenship, claiming that Scotland would have to have a manned, hard border with England after independence. This was backed up by Ed Miliband, claiming that new members of the EU must accept free travel. Ireland has had a pre-existing free travel agreement with the UK, which, as well as being an EU member, also has an opt-out of Schengen. That's the travel area in Europe. If the UK, listen, bear in mind this is back in 2014-2015. If the UK leaves the EU, Ireland would no longer have an automatic opt-out. But we've seen modern day Brexit stuff causing a stinky problem across there, but it seems to be working for them because their trade is excellent with that massive trading bloc called the EU. But now, we're in 2022, we understand better that our common travel area within the UK is one that predates the existence of the EU as an entity. It will only ever be Westminster that will shrug this travel area within the within these islands. Also, we are no longer part of the EU and we've lost the ability to travel freely across the whole of Europe. Whose fault is this? It's not Scotland's. You know, crazy times. Okay, the next part in the article was about defence. The Ministry of Defence in 2014 announced 13 Type 26 frigates, with Defence Secretary Michael Falcon making it clear that the investment was conditional on Scots rejecting independence. Wow. Wow. That's just awful. In the end, the order looked like just being 8 ships, as the money is needed, was needed, to pay for new nuclear weapons. We just all want those nukes, don't we? Expect more of this nonsense and fear-mongering to come in modern times up here as well. And remember that there will be almost £1 billion spent more on defence in Scotland than presently. How's that? Well, I don't know the figures perfectly. James has got a great video on his TikTok all about defence. So I'm just going to kind of quote roughly what the figures are. James can correct me if I'm wrong in the chat. Round about £3.5 billion in defence contributions come from Scottish fiscal taxation, but only what about around £1.5 to maybe £1.7 billion is actually spent in Scotland. And we're looking in an independent Scotland if we go with the original plan of about £2.5, £2.7 billion being spent. So we would actually spend a wee bit more up here. And bear in mind that we're also entitled to our fair share of military assets come independence. And this is not us just going, oh, we'll have that, and we'll have that. It doesn't work that way. It would be negotiated during the transition. So for all those defence sceptics, Scotland would not be left defenceless. But what about NATO? What about NATO then, I hear you cry? Well, ask yourself this. Do you really think that NATO will leave its North Atlantic flank defenceless? Do you think that they would deny Scotland membership because of that? I don't think so. Westminster might. They might try to block that. That would be pretty petty, wouldn't it? They'd be putting themselves at risk with that. So I'm sure that Westminster would be brought to heel by the other members of NATO quite quickly, considering Scotland's strategic location. That's truly something to think about, isn't it? You know what I like to do when I have unionist friends that say, what about defence, Mo? What about defence? You know, we're not going to have anything. We've got defence. I says, of course we will. We've got all these lovely military bases. We'll just rent them out to Russia and China and they'll look after us. And their faces just go, it's like, honest to God, they're chewing a sack of wasps and lemons at the same time. What? It's just hilarious. Hilarious. Anyway, our final video, okay, in the series, the series of Better Together ones, is the famous one. The famous one with that lady sitting at her breakfast table talking about voting no. Let's play that one just now.
Best time of the day, this. When they're all out, nice and quiet. Give you time to think. Helps you clear your head. Shame it only lasts for 2 minutes. Do you know, my Paul is worse than the telly these days. He will not leave off about the referendum. He started again first thing this morning. Have you made a decision yet? I was like, it's too early to be discussing politics. Eat your cereal. So he starts to ask the kids, I mean, honestly, like he'll get any sense out of them. I mean, they never have their heads out their phones. Don't get me wrong. I know how important this vote is. There's not much time left for me to make a decision. But there's only so many hours in the day. And there's a lot to weigh up. I mean, could we keep the pound? That guy off the telly promises us we can. It'll all be fine, he says. Yeah, right. I've heard that one before. Oil will pay for it all. So you can rely on oil for everything, can you? The kids' school, our local hospital, mum and dad's pension. It all sounds a bit too good to be true, if you ask me. You know, the thing is, I've heard plenty of promises, but straight answers, they seem a little bit harder to come by. Paul says we have to do what's best for the country. And that's why it's so difficult to decide, isn't it? I'm just as proud of Scotland as he is. I mean, it's my country. Of course I want what's best for it. And most of all, I want what's best for my children. And their children. It's not like you can change your mind in 4 years' time. They have to live with the decision I make. I suppose that's why all this uncertainty bothers me so much. The more I think about it, independence seems like one big gamble. Like it's not been thought through. And there's one thing I do know, I will not be gambling with my children's future. Do you know what? I've made up my mind. I'm going to do what's best for Scotland. So, that'll be a no from me. Time to get to work.
That was like a serious Better Together video, and it caused quite a lot of controversy when it was aired. I loved PBC's little comment there, is this River City? Was it you that said it? I don't know. There was something about River City there. Oh, there's Druss. Did I say hello to you, Druss? I'm sorry if I've missed you out, my friend. I'm glad to see you back in the chat again, which is good. But yeah, so many people watched that, and it was aired quite a few times, and it was more hard-hitting than the other two. And it got like a really positive response because it was like allegedly a normal person talking about all those things that really made people think hard about voting yes or voting no. There is actually a follow-up video to this made a couple of years ago for one of the elections with the same actress in it, and we're going to play that in a little while because it's quite interesting seeing the follow-up to it all. Right, so let's finish with the last 4 points of the article, and then we'll play that video, and then we'll go and have a wee look at the papers and play the Murdo video as we usually do. So in the old article, it started to talk about tourism. The No Camp claimed Scottish tourism was being damaged by the referendum, and specifically that the UK interest in travel to Scotland was down by 29%. Yet figures for 2014 and 2015 show Scotland had a record tourism year with a 9% increase in holiday trips and a 41% increase in business trips. Now, the pandemic may have caused a drop in tourism, and Brexit certainly has. But you know what? When we're independent and we return to the EU, expect that positive vibe of EU tourism to boost this industry greatly. Oil was the next one on the list of things to talk about on the article. Scots were told that they couldn't have a sovereign oil fund back at in the Better from the Better Together campaign, as it would be, it wouldn't be viable whilst running a deficit. And that old nugget, the deficit. We should do a programme just about the deficit and where it all lands. But then Westminster announced that the northeast of England could have a fracking fund. No, that was fracking fund, okay? To make sure the local communities benefit from their oil wealth. Also, they said oil was running out. And then most recently, in just, a couple of weeks ago or a few days ago, Labour, those plucky little Tory huggers, have said that they want to create a sovereign energy fund for the people of the UK if they get into power. Guess where that energy is coming from? That's right, you guessed correctly. It's coming from Scotland. Mental. Right, where did we get to? We're on the second from last one. Okay, good. Corporation taxes. They were labelled unhealthy and a race to the bottom, and Scotland was told the tax couldn't be devolved to Holyrood, but it was actually devolved to Northern Ireland. Okay, when we step into 2022, and specifically in the 40-odd Days of Truss, that could be the title of a film, 40 Days of Truss. We can see how manipulating the markets with tax cuts can truly have a detrimental effect on the economy. Incidentally, Douglas Ross was screeching about Scotland following Westminster with the cuts, but because we have partial control over certain tax rates, Holyrood decided not to. They'd have looked pretty crappy if they followed Westminster down that path, though, wouldn't they? In an independent Scotland, we would most definitely eliminate the tax loopholes that Westminster seemed to love so much. We already have a progressive tax system, so who's to say we could not have an even fairer and more productive tax system still? The last point in the article that was on Business for Scotland and also in the Press and Journal, way back 2014-2015, was about big business. This is my favourite one. Scots were told that big financial institutions would leave Scotland in droves, come a yes vote. It turned out that they would just re-register but keep the jobs here. Keep the jobs here, and that would have destroyed the bank bailout myth. But now Scottish widows have relocated anyway, and ironically, HSBC, basically who were threatening to leave if we did a Brexit, have now actually moved their headquarters to France because of Brexit. Hilarious. Okay, manufacturing and investment would potentially be an incredible future for Scotland as well. So think of all the big businesses that would come in that need water to manufacture their goods. Water is a vital element in pretty much manufacturing anything. And Scotland has gallons of it, lots of it. Okay, and we're a rainy country and we get lots of it. It's a renewable commodity all the time. We also have a highly educated population, probably the highest educated population in the UK. In fact, it is the highest educated population in the UK. Is it 47% of us have university degrees? We also have that abundance of water thing that I said, which is the vital component in manufacturing. And soon the world will start to tax manufactured goods that have not been made with renewable energy. Yes, that is a thing. It has been talked about at all the COPs, and Scotland is blessed with an embarrassing potential for clean energy. So let's think about that for a minute. Highly educated population, gallons of water, lots of renewable energy. Do you think those three things would be an attractive element to bring outward investment into Scotland for manufacturing and big business? I think it would. I really do. We also sit on a North Atlantic gateway to Europe, and 72% of us want to return to the EU. So then there'd be that free flow of goods from Scotland across to Europe. God, it's just a no-brainer. Do you really think that big business is actually going to ignore these factors? I get quite excited talking about that. That's why my voice went off on a oner there. Right. There are probably a lot more deliberate lies and spinning manipulation that we could discuss here, but I feel that most of Scotland, with the help of 12 years of Tory governments, have had their eyes opened to this sort of nonsense and dirty tricks. It doesn't mean we stop fighting the propaganda. We never stop fighting the propaganda. But now we can confidently highlight what came from Business for Scotland article and more, and place this information in an updated context like I've done with several of the points tonight. So to finish this segment of me rambling on, I want to quote a Twitter person called Wee Scribbles. If you don't follow Wee Scribbles, go and find Wee Scribbles. And this is a highly relevant tweet, and it's a great tweet. So I'm going to read off what she's done, okay? This time, in this campaign, we will ask the questions. And the questions are such as this. What oil are you going to use? Where are you going to keep your nukes? Where will you get your fresh water? Where will you get your renewable energy? What will you do with all those Scottish peers in the House of Lords? How will you survive on such a weak pound? You know, do you really want to ostracise the second largest consumer group outside of London? Will you be okay being left alone outside the EU? And finally, can you ship 5.7 million people to Rwanda? Oh my, how the tables have turned.
My name is Hero, and I have a question for you. Are you yes yet?
My mic on? Yes, it is. I thought I'd push the button to come off. That was Hero. He's a very good friend of mine. He's a German national that lived in Manchester and moved to Scotland. He is a proper Indy warrior as well up here and believes wholeheartedly in independence, which is great. So we have one little video that's kind of related to that, and that is the next one that was in the kind of in the sequence. This is the follow-up to the one about the lassie, which is good. So we'll play that just now, and then we'll come back and do something else as well.
Morning. Remember me?
There I was, face of the No campaign. Well, a lot's happened since our last wee chat, hasn't it? Oh, 2014 seems like a lifetime ago. A generation, even.
Remember last time round, they were all, everything will be fine if you just vote No. And we did. I suppose I thought we were voting for everything to stay the same. We didn't think we were voting for all this madness since. Elections every 2 minutes. I wasn't voting for Brexit. And I know I wasn't voting to put that blonde bluffer in charge. I thought it was bad enough the independence referendum being on the TV for months. But Brexit went on for years. I mean, don't they have other things they should be doing?
All just seems clearer now. I wish Nicola was running things. She's genuine, you know. She can fix everything, but you get the sense that she's the one who's actually trying.
So next time, I think I will be voting yes. I'm not 100% sure, but I can see now that we definitely can make a success of it. Paul's been great about it. He joined the SNP after the last vote. He goes on marches now.
Tries to get me to go with him. At least he doesn't say, I told you so, like some of them. He's good that way. Right now he's always talking about this guy with an Italian name, Mario or something. He says he'd be great as our next MSP. People round here remember him from last time. I mean, it's not like we ever see the current one. Well, except on TV. She's off to be a baroness now. Good time to be off. One last thing before I go, just in case you were wondering. In the mornings, Paul has porridge now. I prefer muesli. It's been a long time since either of us sat down and ate our cereal.
Okay, just a wee bit interesting turn of books there with the same actress doing more up-to-date one. I think that was for the 2019 election. I could be wrong. I'm just going to quickly have a look at the chat there. BBC, everything that you're saying there is quite valid. They'll build nuclear power stations, I have to say. They're building so many of them just now. So, yeah, good luck with that. Okay, and what else have you said there? And where will they get their water? The south of England is 900 miles from Scotland. Did you not read that they wanted to make a national grid of water? I mean, that's what they were considering. Probably about as valid as the bridge to Ireland. But do you know what? These are all things, okay, that are used to scaremonger voters up here. It doesn't mean they're actually going to happen, my friend. Okay, it's just the manipulation and scaremongering. You don't have to take them seriously. Okay, So it's just to point things out to people, right? Because last time it was like, what pound are you going to have? What currency are you going to have? What are you going to do about this? What are you going to do about that? The whole point of me asking those questions there from Wee Scribbles was to say, we're asking the questions now because people are more awake. Okay, there you go. Do you honestly think we have a massive different climate? No, we don't. But it's funny how down in the south of England and various parts of England that you have water shortages more than you have up here. Hosepipe bans. And farmers were a bit worried about watering their crops and things. So, yeah, you do have a bit of a different climate from up here. You get a lot hotter down... Well, I'm not saying you, I don't know where you live, but certainly parts of England get a lot hotter than they do in Scotland. Okay, I think that's something you have to bear in mind. That's kind of factual, my friend. Okay, so we're not going to do the daily affirmations today. We're going to ask the pertinent question, and let's ask PBC this question, actually. Okay, this is for you, my friend. Okay, let me get my question up here. With absolute open-mindedness and love for our fellow Scots, of course, can anyone, someone, please give me an honest case for Scotland to remain in the Union, one that truly does not involve anything that mocks or belittles your Scottish neighbours, okay? Not one that turns around and sort of comes up with the Scotland bad thing, all right? A positive reason, one that is good for Scotland, that's not based on nostalgia or fear-mongering. I'll wait. Not a good answer, PBC.
If Scotland leaves the UK, we lose roughly a third of the landmass of Great Britain, probably around half of our territorial waters. We lose the magnificent resource that is Scottish fishing waters. We lose the opportunities from North Sea oil and gas. We lose the potential for renewable energy from Scotland's coasts and in the North Sea and the Atlantic. We lose access to barrier-free trade for Scotch whiskey and Scotch salmon, all these fantastic exports. The opportunity to study at some of the world's greatest universities in Scotland, and the joy of having Scots as part of the British nation. Why would you want to throw that away?
Okay, so economies of scale. That's just a buzzword, mate. Give me some facts. Just not do it tonight because we don't have time to listen to you, okay? So economies of scale, nice little buzzword, okay? Explain factually what you mean by that another time. Can't be bothered listening to you tonight, my friend, okay? Okay, let's go on. Right, so the Murdo video. That video now has had about 17,000 views on Twitter, and it's great because Murdo likes to tell us what the Union would lose. You know, I mean, what was that? Two-thirds of the territorial waters. How does that compare to the scale of the waters round the rest of the Union? Okay, right, good. So if you want to actually have a look at that video and pass it on to other people, by all means do so. You can do so by going to @yes_Scots on Twitter. It is pinned to my little first posty bit there. Okay, so by all means, go for it. Okay, go for it. Right, shall we have a look at tomorrow's papers? I think we will. Let us go and change this to this. There we go. Is there any more? Let's scroll back up. Oh, I didn't have them ready. Let's go. Papyrus time. And I need to bring it up on my pad of eyes as well. There we go. Now then. Okay. Need to refresh that. Right, so the first paper, okay, is The Times, and we're only looking at the headlines today. Alarm at Braverman's immigration rhetoric. He doesn't look too happy there. I'm zooming right in on my pad of eyes there to have a wee look at that. And she really, really doesn't look great. She looks a bit iffy. What does it say in the buzzy wordy part for that? Suella Braverman on her way to the Commons when she claimed to be the victim of opponents wanting to get rid of her. No wonder. She should never have been given that job back, in all fairness, you know? Let's just be honest about it. Okay, next papaya. Wait. Oh yes, here we go again. Same picture in the eye. Cabinet anger as Braverman fights for her political life. I remember there was a headline once that said Boris was fighting for his political life, and then Truss was fighting for her political life, you know? So there we go. Sweller channel migrant crisis out of control. That's right, she said that we were in an uncontrollable invasion of migrants. It's a disgrace, her getting her job back. Yeah, I totally agree with you. I'm barely conscious. Totally agree with you. I've not brought the paper up. There we go. That's the Daily Fail, though. That, you know, paper of incredibleness. That's really good. Oh my God, look at this picture. Hot House of Commons. You've got to love the Daily Star for their nonsense. They're the ones that did that lettuce thing with Truss. MPs are sweltering in a tropical 30 degrees inside the House of Commons, yet hard-up Brits can't afford to heat their homes. Our members of Parliament even leave windows open for a cooling breeze. Wow. Bit of a piss take, really, isn't it? It's so toasty, windows left open all winter. Very good. Very good, very good, very good. Let's go on. What's the next one? The Guardian. It's not really much to, you know, these days. The political stuff is not that great. However, the next couple of papers may trigger people because it does discuss the refugees and migrant issue. Braverman increases the refugee rhetoric as pressure grows to quit. Home Secretary refuses to take blame for dire state of asylum centre. Well, she's the top person for it. So she should be taking responsibility or going to fix it. You can't just turn around and sort of blame it on your predecessors. Yeah, you can in a certain extent, but you have to say, look, this is a problem. We need to fix it. I'll take responsibility. Let's go fix it. But I'm sure that, you know, at the start of the show tonight, we talked about how she turned around and openly denied that she put a stop on the use of hotels and things in that area. Welcome to the UK. No beds, no fresh air, no toilet doors. What? No compassion. I think we need to be doing more. You know, I know that some people might, you know, disagree with everything that kind of goes on with the migrant problem and everything, but you know what? I think we need to do a little bit more. There has to be a change in policy. We can't just keep people housed up like animals. Wait a minute, I suppose they did want to send people to Rwanda. There's the fix. I missed out on that one, didn't I? Really? Okay, let's go back to the papers. Righty, oh, papers on OBS as well. There we go, excellent. Right, so Financial Times. Okay, dream of UK battery champion dims as British vote teeters towards what the hell? Ministers reject. You know what? See, when I look at the Financial Times sometimes, I'm looking at it going, what does this stuff mean? And I spend a day looking some of this stuff up that's pertinent. Braverman fights for job as being accused of law-breaking in an asylum row. He doesn't really care. She just thinks she's one of the people doing the good stuff. And that, there, wow, the papers were really quite dull today, weren't they? That's what it looks like when I do that on... what's it called? There we go, we want that button. Brilliant, that's us back to normal there. Okay, have a quick look in chats. Okay, nothing's jumping out there. Right, so when we're in chat, we try our best to be nice to each other on this one. And I'm going to be giving some people moderator rights on this and some straightforward rules and stuff like that. So We try our best to be nice to each other and civil in here. Bear in mind that it's the live belongs to my account, and I just want people to be civil. So let's just be cool, right? I don't think anybody's being uncool, but I might have missed the context of a couple of things. So yeah. Where did we go to? Oh, there's George. Hiya, George. How are you? And Nicolasi? How are you tonight? We will just finish going through this. Okay, so we're going to... What time is it? I have managed... Yes! I managed to keep it to an hour. Totally happy. Totally happy. Right, I have... Do I have another video for you? There was one I was going to play. It was a Rishi Sunak one. And it was kind of to remind us... that he's a lying so-and-so, basically. And we shouldn't actually be thinking that he's going to be a good Prime Minister. But I don't remember which where I've put that one. Which button is it? There was 5. Maybe it's number 6. Let's give this a try and see if it's the right one.
You live and work in this building where there were multiple gatherings during lockdown. Were you aware of any of them?
No, I wasn't.
No, Mr. Speaker, I did not attend any parties.
For the record, Chancellor, you knew of nothing of any of these gatherings, even one that happened outside that window.
People think I'm standing out here looking outside that window. I spent half my time in the Treasury as well.
It is now a fact. Through their pain, our leaders partied. The Prime Minister, the Chancellor, making the laws and breaking the laws, all in the same building. Tonight, Rishi Sunak said in a statement, "I offer an unreserved apology. I understand that for figures in public office, the rules must be applied stringently in order to maintain public confidence. I respect the decision that has been made and have paid the fine."
Okie dokie. A small reminder that Rishi Sunak is a liar. Okay, and this liar has allowed Isabella Braverman, Cruella Braverman, to get her job back. And they're running the country. Well, they're running these islands. What can I say? Wouldn't happen in the same way up here as it's done down there. We're not perfect. Truly, we're not perfect. I mean, that's obvious. But having an unelected PM in place that's not willing to put his integrity to the vote with a general election is something that we have to bear in mind. It's just another push in the direction of independence, as far as I'm concerned. More people will just flock to this side because of those sort of things. Oh, he is elected. Of course he is. Of course he is. He wasn't elected as a Prime Minister, though, PBC. You just like to bait me, don't you? Yeah. I know that. I know how the electoral system works, mate. I really do. But just remember, okay, it's not just about black and white rules. It's kind of like, let's look at the whole picture for things. Let's look at, he's come in, he's the second Conservative MP since the last general election. It's been put in place just by a whole bunch of Tory voters. You know? It's not really just a grey area, though, is it? Just like a straight up, not black and white. It's... I think if they were doing a good job, it would have probably been more acceptable. But you can't say that they're doing a good job, can you? Anyway, that's enough of that. We're going to call it a night just now. I don't know, shall we play that cheesy end music that I like to play? Let's just get along here. And there's the end stuff there. So yeah, we'll call it a night. Listen, thank you everybody once again for coming in and joining in the conversation, having a chit-chat. And even PBC, I thank you for your input as well, my friend. It's always good to have a different voice coming in. Truly it is. And yeah, let's say bye-bye. I'll be back tomorrow night with something. Not quite sure yet. Maybe something on the economies of scale. I don't know. But we'll call it a night here and let's hear our cheesy end music. So thank you for listening. Good night and good luck.
O flower of Scotland, When will we see your like again? That fought and died for your wee bit hill and glen, and stood against him. Proud Edward's army, and sent him homeward to think again. The hills are bare now, and autumn leaves lie thick and still. Or land that is lost now, which those so dearly held that stood against him. Proud Edward's army, and sent him home.